ones.
I was wondering.
It's one of the ones that we take to the shows with us. So actually, funny story, not funny story. Because of the way things have kind of moved around and done some things and all that, that's actually a king size mattress.
Is it really?
Yeah, with the thing over the top of it, because I bought a couple of the purple mattresses, and because back troubles, all that kind of fun stuff. So when I bought the king size purple mattress, we were deciding what are we going to do, and our kids have moved out, and so now I moved my studio into one of the kids' bedrooms, and it just. I put it up and I'm like, you know, that looks like that's about the right size. So, booyah. Anyhow, hey there, hi there, ho there out there in spray wash land. Ray will be with us here in just a minute when there he is. And he's sneaking in the middle there. I'm going to move him back out the middle. There you go. Because we have a special guest with us this evening who is Everett Abrams. And if you don't know who Everett is, he is considered the Wizard of Wood. And he knows all about restoring wood and all that kind of fun stuff. Unlike me, I know how to destroy wood. So, it's been one of them things that has always, I don't want to say escaped me. I just didn't want to go after the wood stuff. We didn't have enough of it here. I'm sure that there is a lot more than I realized or, you know, that kind of thing. I just didn't want to go after it. So, one of those kind of things. So, Everett, even though I'm sure most people know you, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Geez, how did you start a little after 30 years of this stuff?
There you go.
Well, most people know me as the Wizard of Wood. It's a name that was given a long time ago. I tried to shake it, didn't shake it, so I embrace it now. So we tie it into the products as well. So we have two companies we basically run. One's a contracting company. It does restoration, deck building, most of it geared towards wood. I still tell everybody, and we put in our literature, that we're still the largest pressure washing company in South Jersey, which goes up all my competitors' ass, but I still do more pressure washing than they do. So that's just the name of the ball game, whether they like that part of it or not. So we still stick to it. Well, you know what? Jamie Schmidt actually tells people in my area, leave Everett alone. Don't worry about his customers because you're not getting them. they tie in. They get into our maintenance plan. We take care of the pressure washing the house, the siding, the concrete, the pavers, the stamped concrete, the deck, the whole thing. And that's it. And we hang on to them and just wait for us to call. So go ahead and knock on the door because you're probably not getting it. And we don't go for those people looking for price anyway. So,
and you know, you mentioned that as whenever we were pre-gaming here, one of the things that, you know, you said, hey, once you get those customers and they become yours, don't go after them because you're not going to get them anyway. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I mentioned in our little pre-show was I've had multiple people tell me, you know, Ray, the best thing that ever happened to pressure washing in Tallahassee, Florida was you selling your company because we were able to get some of the stuff that you frankly had on lockdown that because there was now a disturbance in the force, we were able to kind of slip in there and get that. So I think that's very accurate what you're saying, Everett. Once you get someone, once you make them a customer, they're yours. Good luck getting
they're yours to lose. That's for true. And if you're focused strictly on price, that's not it's not what keeps your customers. I just had that same discussion with a competitor. Obviously, I don't have any competitors. And now that I've sold my business, that's even different. But same thing. I had the discussion where he was talking about Cajun soft wash. He saw them doing a job he had bid on. And I said, you know, honestly, you didn't have a shot at it anyhow. You know, I mean, I'm not saying that to be arrogant, but I know the customer. I know the client. I know that it's a commercial job. And I know that Cajun soft wash was going to win that job regardless of what you did. So, and just like you said, Everett, there's nothing about the price that even affects that.
Not at all. But you nailed it. It's up to us to lose the customer. And I believe that anytime the phone rings today, I keep telling everybody that sales has been out the window for a while. It's trust. When people call you, they've already decided on you. It's up to you to lose the sale. They've already done the background check, the Google, checked you out, got reference, whatever the hell. It's up to you to lose the sale. And I think that's what we do. We lose customers, we lose sales because they're already there.
Mm-hmm. You know, as we said earlier, people, the the COVID thing back in 2020, I know you said your business exploded, you know, during that time. Our residential exploded during 2020. COVID was an absolute blessing to many of us in the residential aspect of stuff, because I mean, Everett, talk about, you know, you're saying they're putting in decks like crazy, because you also, not only do you restore, but you're also building and constructing new decks. We saw people took a fervent interest in maintaining their properties because they weren't going into work. And for the first time, you know, in quite a while, they were standing out doing Zoom meetings from their backyards and looking around going, this place looks like shit,
Yeah. I'll tell you what, the whole COVID thing, it was the same for me, where I was dead certain when COVID happened. I thought, all right, guys, gear up. Our commercial is going to go through the roof and our residential is just going to be completely dead. And it was actually opposite. When COVID first hit, our commercial just dried up dead, but our residential just went through the roof. And people would say, yeah, now that we're home, you know, we're looking around and, you know, like you said, we're doing our Zoom meetings and, you know, the place just looks bad and, you know, boom.
Plus, the longer it went, the more they invested in that staycation. Mm-hmm. And the more they invested in the backyard, the more they've got. And I'm telling you, it's got legs. And because of all that, if you're selling, put it this way, if you went through that whole thing and you didn't sell maintenance and you didn't sell that next service, you missed out.
Yeah.
Because that was huge. And people are looking for contractors. They spent all this money on these pavers and these stamped concrete and these decks and everything outdoors. They want somebody they can rely on. And we took advantage of it. So we built a composite deck. We said, be careful of the pressure washers that are doing this, because if they're bleaching, they could void the warranty. But hey, by the way, guess what? We also offer pressure washing and soft washing services. And since we built a good deck for you, just give us a call and we'll take care of it for you.
Yeah.
And we call them. So
absolutely.
Maintenance.
100%. I mean, it's the gift that keeps on giving, you know, and I don't mean to be, you know, off color here, but yeah, there's the old joke about there was the old bull and the young bull that were sitting up on the hill, you know, under the tree and looking around, and the farmer had just backed up a whole new herd of cows down there. And the young bull's looking at the guy and at the old bull and goes, hey, let's run down that hill and screw a cow right now, man. Let's just run down there and screw a cow. And the old bull said, no, son, let's walk down there and screw all of them. You know, you forget about the long game on things and your rush to go and do as many jobs as you can or to get as many new customers. What if you just got the right amount of customers and you kept getting money from them over and over again?
That's one of the reasons, you know, when I looked at, and we've talked about this dozens of times, and Everett, you're absolutely right. You know, selling the maintenance is what is going to help you keep and maintain customers forever and ever. Amen. And there are so many things that you can do along that maintenance line, even whether it's a roof cleaning, a house wash, a deck build, you know, whatever it is, whatever your forte is. I mean, I don't care if it's house painting, if it's landscaping, if it's I don't know of anything that you could throw at me that I couldn't come up with some sort of a maintenance plan or maintenance program to help. I mean, it's a service business. That's what you do.
So let's talk about a couple things then with that. First of all, I would say anybody who's working in this industry, like I have heart, you guys have heart, you spend a lot of time and effort. What is your asset? Your asset is your customers, your maintenance. Mm-hmm. So even if I am a new person, if you're new and you're watching this tonight, if you're only going to get in this game for 1, 2, 3 years, you say, you know what? I'm out. I don't want to do this. At least you worked hard for 3 years. You've got a customer base. You have a customer list to sell, especially if you work from the beginning on maintenance. That's your asset. I sure know that if I was only going to work 3 to 5 years and said, you know what, I'm going to scrap this, but I had something to sell. And if I got 35, 50,000, whatever the hell it is, at least I got something. I didn't work for free and sell my equipment like everybody else does. And so do a lot of landscapers and other service industry people. And I don't get that.
I don't get it either.
And the largest company in the largest pressure washing company in the world didn't buy me out for my equipment.
Yes.
You know,
there you go.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, you just like you're saying, I've seen it so many times where guys are like, nah, you know, they got out of the business. And you're like, what'd you do with your customer base? Well, I mean, I didn't do anything, you know, or I just turned my phone off, or, you know, whatever it was that they did, you know, I just referred them to somebody else. I'm like, why did you do that? I mean, well, I didn't have that many customers. I mean, I might've had, you know, 100 customers, you know, or something like that. And you're like, there was value in that.
Right. But if you had 100, let's say you were sitting there grossing $100,000 a year, but those were repeat 100 customers that went to you year after year after year, I guarantee you there is a business that would want to absorb you and at least give you some kind of value for that, other than the value of a 6-year-old freaking Honda 690 with 2,500 hours on it, you know?
100%.
Yep.
Now, the other thing people don't talk about with maintenance is, and I can even tie this into wood, a lot of times we don't even think of this, but I bet you I could go down to Florida. And if I was in Florida, you know where I would be selling my wood services? I'd be at every commercial hotel, resort, park, everything. They all have teak benches, all that stuff out there. Yep. And guess what else I'd be doing? I'd be setting up myself with route work. I'd be taking care of that outdoor furniture, windows, concrete around the pool. I'd be everywhere. So there's a tie-in to some of this stuff. And by the way, teak is a good way to get into teak and outdoor furniture. That became huge. I'm sure down there, like it did up here, you couldn't go indoors. Everybody had to eat outdoors. All these places still up here have outdoor furniture. People are eating outdoor spaces too. It is so easy. Once it's restored, you go in, you get some warm, soapy water, you clean it up, get the hands grease from the hands, and then you just wipe on a coat, gone, see ya. And you don't even have to do it every time. Sometimes you can just clean it and then maybe put some teak oil on or some mesmers, whatever the hell you're putting on, you know, every other time. It's easy. It really is. Now, I had a guy take the wood class the last one. He's up in North Jersey, and he said he scrapped his whole business, Mark, went out after this stuff, and he's doing just almost all furniture now.
Wow.
People don't realize how much is out there. And well, they get it done in-house, and it doesn't work, just so you know.
You know, it's funny you mentioned that, but I think back to I was offered a contract with Walgreens around a large area of Walgreens, and I turned it down, but it was doing all of their interior glass, none of the exterior, all of their interior glass, you know, and Walgreens has those security mirrors that are beveled down at a, like, you know, and I'm sitting there looking at me going, I'm looking going, gosh, there's so much freaking interior glass here. And I thought the rate was incredibly low. And I talked to a long-term window cleaner, and I was telling him, you know, after I had let it pass, and he said, you're an absolute moron for letting that pass. And I can't remember what the rate was, something like, you know, $300 a store, something like that. And he goes, you're a moron for letting that go. He said, because the first time you go in there and clean it, the second, third, fourth, fifth time you go in there, you're really just touching up the dirty spots on there. And that was, you know, several years ago. And all of a sudden maintenance kind of clicked on me whenever I got that. I was like, oh, you're right. I don't have to reclaim.
And now water fed poles make it even easier.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you got it right.
Yeah.
Right. And it's on the outside.
Yeah. I'm telling you, people do not put the emphasis on the right thing. But you know what? Part of that is I think some of it's our fault, but yeah. I've been around for a while. I think we've talked a lot of technical stuff. I don't think we get to the business part of it a lot. And a lot of this stuff is just kind of business 101. And I know a lot of people want to jump on Facebook groups and, you know, ask what the price of bleach is 100 times over, you know, in their area. And I'm being critical, but yay.
Yeah. But it's true.
It's absolutely true. We should be talking about things like building a business.
Yeah.
Get the automate stuff. I get all that stuff. Hey, whatever's a flash in the pan. But, man, building a sustainable business and putting some other systems in place that work for different people, I think, are really good. But some of it should be for the long term, and some of it is business 101. But.
Well, and you know, so, hold on, Doug. Tagging on that, I think so many people go, well, And I'm making numbers up, but okay, this deck wash is $500, but this deck maintenance is only $150. I don't want only $150. I want that 500 for the initial. I don't care about doing 150, but it's like, but wait a minute, the initial takes you 3 hours to do. The 150 that now occurs every quarter or 6 months or that takes you 30 minutes to do. So it's
your profit's actually higher.
Yeah, your profit's much higher, and you're getting it multiple times, you know, a year on that.
Okay, so let's talk about that. And you can probably relate this to everything you guys have done in the past too. And we don't talk about this. Every time we see these guys come on Facebook groups, and again, it's not, they don't talk about business. So this is going to hit the business part of it, but watch how this ties in. We never talk, like people say, how much do you charge to clean a deck? And somebody will say, okay, whatever the price is. Why would you listen to that ass? First of all, how high is it off the ground? What's the coating? Does this have to be stripped? What? There's so many scenarios.
Right.
So nobody ever asks all the right questions. They just say, oh, well, I charge $2. I charge $2 to clean, $3 to strip. Check this out. Watch this. Clean and seal. We all know that sealers are easy to apply. Watch this. How about clean and a semi-transparent? Now it's starting to get a little more opaque. It's a little more like painting, a little more detail. Mm-hmm. Now let's go clean and a solid stain.
Mm-hmm.
Now I just came up with three prices, right? Now watch this one. Clean, sand, seal. Clean, sand, semi. Clean, sand, solid. Now I got six prices. Now check this out. Change clean out and put strip in.
Mm-hmm.
Now I've got 12 prices. Mm-hmm. How many people talk about price list?
Right.
We never talk about a price list. And I can tell you this, ready for this one? I do this in the class. If somebody does 100 decks a year at 750 square feet on an average, and that's not big if you count the railings and everything. It's just an average deck. Nobody's not going to hire you because you're 50 cents a square foot higher than somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have a price list, then what happens is you're just leaving it out in the wind. But on 100 decks, 750 square feet, that's 37,500 at the end of the year. That's a better car. That's, remember, we pre-gaming. I'm going to Aruba on Thursday, everybody.
Right.
A better trip. That's better equipment for your company. And I only took 50 cents on one scenario, not even the 12 different prices. So, I mean, that's the problem with wood. And it's also a lot of the problem with other stuff. We don't come up with a price list. We don't get what we should. And the other thing, too, about the price list is I can tell the customer when they say, hey, can you take $100 off? I'm sorry, we have a price list.
Which service do you want me to take off? Yeah.
And what's amazing, though. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What service do you not want? You don't want it stripped? Okay, cool. We'll just stain over the old stuff. We're not responsible whenever it starts flaking up. But, you know, and it's so true there, what you're saying about the price list, it also makes you an expert in that respect, because, you know, we've always said, like, whenever somebody goes, oh, well, you can't, you know, the last guy looked at the picture on Google and gave me a price there. Oh, God, I love hearing that whenever somebody says, the guy said, you know, looked at my house on Google and gave me the price. Well, how can they tell what the siding is? How can they tell if it's oxidized? How can they tell if what your landscaping is? How can they tell the age of your roof? How can they tell blah, blah, blah? And all of a sudden, you're now becoming such an expert. And those are you want the customers that want experts. You don't want the customers that want the low price. You want the customers that want the experts. And now you're going, damn, yes, this is who I want. This is what I want. This is important to me. Oh, wait, and you have a price list. Wow, now I'm not really getting screwed at all either.
That's where, for me, package pricing really, I mean, it helped our company as well, because in a package, you're listing all the different items, right? And then you're saying these items go to package A, these items for package B, and these items for package C. So they do. They have that price list of all the different things that are on there. And that's what they see and can add the value up right there in front of you.
I like the fact when I waived the price list, like Ray saying, it takes you to a different level. And the customer that identifies with you and says, that company has a price list. That makes sense. They're professional. I trust them. That's the company I want. Well, that's the customer I want.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm also painting a picture that attracts them to me, but I also want those people. The people that come back and say, your price is too high. Well, okay.
Sorry.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
And Brenda, your question has already been answered. You were late, and that is your fault, not Everett's, not mine, and not Ray. So,
but I mean, and to answer Brenda's question, what are your thoughts on how busy it'll be during the recession?
Okay, I can answer that real quick and easy. Ready for this? If you're worried about the recession and recession-proofing your business, you're already too late. Mm-hmm. The time to recession-proof your business is with your business model before this happens. So, I go back to this where everybody was hell-bent on one way, but not sustaining a business that's going to, I mean, let's face it. If people don't have the money, they don't have the money. You can't force them to spend the money. Right.
Yes.
How are you going to market to the $99 guy or the person that
you're never going to?
Right.
Yeah.
It's going to work.
You shouldn't have been marketing to them in the first place.
I agree. And that's our business model goes towards those people that are looking for the maintenance. They're not going to slouch on the maintenance. If you spend, like we build decks for the people that don't know, if people have a 25-year, 30, 50-year guarantee, whatever on the decking, you think they're not going to keep up with it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of course, they're going to keep it clean. They're going to maintain it. Same thing with people with a wood deck. A wood deck's going to be like 20 years plus. Of course, they're going to take care of it. They're not going to let the sun destroy it. And then the same thing with all the money they spent out there. And that's another thing. I think the pandemic.
But that's your job, though, Everett. I mean, that's on you. If you don't. So let's go back to it and say a 50-year warranty on a deck, right? You want that customer for those 50 years. So you want to say, you know, hey, Everett, you know, your 6-month cleaning is coming up. Just wanted to make sure you wanted to maintain your warranty. Here are the benefits. If you're not doing that to maintain your customer, it's not just about maintaining their site. It's about maintaining them as your customer, keeping up with them and all that. So that way you're bringing them back in and making sure that they stay your customer as well.
100%.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, this goes back to about 2010 or so. I had just started my company. Things were tight. Things were really rough. And I remember it was February, and there's a neighborhood. It's actually within probably about a 5-wood hit of my office right now. And I remember there were 1,400 to 1,700 square foot houses. They were real simple cookie cutter houses. At that time, they were $150,000-$160,000. And I went out there and I made a special door hanger for the neighborhood, about 300 houses, because I'm like, look, I can get in here, get in and get out and get these houses done. I did literally an $89 special house wash because it was February and my ass was hungry. So I went out there and door hung the whole neighborhood. I got, I think, one call out of 300 flyers in February from an $89 special. You know why? Because people who need an $89 house wash can't afford the $89 house wash in February when the Christmas bills are coming due. Mm-hmm. I was going after the wrong customer at that time. Was not recession.
But that's part of learning business too. And that's one of the things I think that we do here on the show to begin with. You know, we get a lot of people that are first timers and new and all that. And they always hear us talking about, you know, raise your prices, raise your prices, raise your prices. These are the exact things that we're talking about. And Everett's helping bring those to light to where these are the reasons that you want to do that. These are these are some of the ways that you get there to help you do these things. The maintenance programs are something that are going to help you with your pricing.
So Brenda asked about the recession and the maintenance through the pandemic and yada yada. So something along those lines. I don't see it up there now, but I want to answer this. Back in 2009, when the shit hit the fan, literally, we all were kind of taken off guard, and we were all living kind of high on the hog at the time. You know, I know I was. I didn't care because money's coming in and going out, and I got kind of complacent myself. I wasn't really looking at what I had been taught how to run my business. In the pandemic did everybody a favor because the fact that people spent so much money on the curb appeal and on the outdoor living space, that hashtag outdoor living space has become huge. Those people invested a lot of money. I just don't see them not spending the money to upkeep and maintain them. And they're the customers I want, the people that spent that money and want to maintain that staycation, that whatever the hell they call it in their backyard.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's where, too, I think a lot of people have missed out. And it's not too late to focus on it. It's not. You know, you've got to remember that all these people are not only were they forced to stay at home, a lot of them are still staying at home.
Yeah.
It's not too late to get into that and start pushing down that path.
Well, you know what, too? There's a void out there because over the last couple of years, what happened? We had the pandemic. We had a lot of union guys that jumped into the field and were doing side work and stuff because there wasn't a lot to do. Where are they now? The union guys are back to work. Mm-hmm. And the people that had to replace their job with a business are going. I've already hired a few of them in my company.
Yeah.
And they're good workers. They're good guys. They didn't have any. Everybody has to survive. So they go and they create a business for themselves. And now they're finding that, hey, things aren't just as rosy as they were before.
That's actually a really good point, because all these guys that have gone out here and who have unfortunately fallen into, I'm starting a soft wash, pressure washing business. You know, don't whenever it comes time to hire in the next year, don't necessarily, because it used to be, 8 years ago, 6 years ago, if you had, that would literally disqualify you for getting hired at Spray Wash if you had pressure washing experience. I don't want you. Because I don't want you to come into my company and tell me how you used to do things. You've already failed once. I'm not doing it your way. But, you know, it is interesting to sit here and think about, you know, there's been so many guys that have lost their jobs or have gone and bought these ridiculously expensive $22,000, $30,000, $40,000 rigs with no, like you said, Everett, business experience on there. And it is inevitable. They're fighting a battle to the bottom. They'll pay $40,000 for a freaking gas roof pump, but they won't spend $100 on an education course to how to run a business, how to properly tape an outlet, how to properly clean a wooden deck. But those people will be coming on the market available as employees here one day soon.
And I found out a lot of them, they have the characteristics I'm looking for, because even if they're not, like you said, it would have disqualified you years ago. I got people that will walk in and say, look, I tried it. It's not what I thought. Or, hey, running a business is not what I want to be. But you know what the characteristic they have? They didn't let the pandemic kick them in the ass. They didn't stay home and collect unemployment. They actually went and tried to get a business, do something, and make some money. That doesn't mean they weren't collecting unemployment, too. But I'm just saying, they did try to run a business. So they were a
hustle. Yeah, that's the entrepreneurial thing, right?
Hey.
Take the hustle.
I got PPP.
Everett, I sent you a friend request on Facebook, but you're tapped out at 5,000 friends. You got to get rid of one so you can have me as your newest questioner.
Okay. Well, hold on. I'm going to tell you the one to get rid of. Ray already has me.
Well, you know what's funny? Me and him were the first two with 5,000.
Yeah.
And I think everybody knew he did, but didn't know I did. I've had 5,000 forever.
Yep. So yeah, so kill get rid of Henry. And you know, you're right. Michael brings up a good point. Recession or not, people still need tax write-offs. I mean, my God, we can. You know, I mean, it is a tax write-off doing your capital improvements, and I mean, God knows that's an important thing to do, and then the sheer maintenance of your house. I mean. Gosh, you know, do it. And again, goes back to the staycations, putting all this money into your backyard. Dear Lord, we see how much we've spent. We've tapped out, you know, because of the rise in real estate values on here. And a lot of these people have not paid for it in cash. They've paid for it on HELOCs and second mortgages and stuff. But yeah.
I want to go back to this one that Truth Seeker had said. It kills him, like how guys put things out in front of Walmart and then they complain about the cheap customers. That is absolutely true. You have to look at where you're marketing at. Are you marketing? What is your target audience? And is your target audience going to that Walmart that you're, you know, putting all your faith and signs in front of?
I'll go further than that. Is your target market attracted to a yard sign? Because in my area, it's demographics. I know people before they start posting, it's going to be in demographic areas too. Some it used to be really great. Some it may still be. You put that in my area, and people might get on a Facebook group and say, do you believe that company putting those shitty signs up, making our community look terrible? There's all kinds of stuff, and it has a negative connotation where it didn't before. Plus, we got townships up here. You're not even allowed to put them out. You get fined.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I think that it's that way in most areas where you're not supposed to put them out, but most people do, and most municipalities don't enforce that, if you would. Some do, and they do it religiously, but others just don't.
No, they don't. They don't, you know, and again, like I said, it's picking the customer you want to go after. If you're, you know, I see it all the time on Facebook now, you know, oh, these people are too cheap to pay $200 for a house wash. And then, you know, it's like somebody calling me up and saying, hey, Ray, you know, and then, you know, keeping me on the phone for 45 minutes. Well, how would you do this? How did you grow your business? Yeah. How much is that pressure washer? It's $3,800. Oh, that's too much. I can get it cheaper online. Thanks.
Click.
Yeah. No, seriously. I mean, it's like, okay, first off, you asked me advice, you know, you're talking to the one guy that actually owns a supply house that's run a really successful business. And you've asked that, but then you're the same guy that's going, I can get it cheaper on eBay, or I can get it cheaper on Amazon on there. So,
okay, so let's take that and go back to business again. Business 101. I do this in class. Who's buying your bleach? Who's buying your wood stripper? And everybody goes, I am. Well, then you're not running your business right, because your customers should be paying for this shit.
Yeah.
They pay for vacation. If you work for a company, you go on vacation. And then I say, somebody, who pays for your vacation? Well, I do. Sometimes I can't afford to go on vacation. Your pricing's not right.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty simple to me. Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah, if you can't afford to go on vacation, there's something wrong with your pricing. Yeah.
Is anybody not hiring somebody, even just to wash a house, because you're paying 25 or 50 cents more a gallon for bleach?
Mm-mm. Nope. I have never paid. For any chemical myself. My customers have paid for it, but I have never, ever, ever. In fact, I love to tell the story, and those who watch for a long time have heard this before, but one of the things, and I had just gotten a big maintenance account that wound up being the second biggest maintenance account in the history of my company. And I was out BSing one night with one of their maintenance workers, and they had several, and they owned a hot washer, and you know, we got to be friends, and he was sitting there kind of looking at my trailer, and he's like, oh man, is that Purple Power? Yeah, it is. Oh, cool. That's what you use out here. I was like, oh, is that Purex? Yeah, it is. And oh, cool. You know, and he's like, man, I can get this stuff at Home Depot. I was like, yeah, you can. He's like, man, I wish the boss would let me go out there and pressure wash. He goes, I'd love some shit to do around here at night, you know. And I'm sitting there going, okay, wow, because I've got consumer grade goods on my trailer that the maintenance just saw, and they own a hot washer, and this ambitious little SOB actually wants something to do. I'm in potential of losing this account, because he could easily go into the boss and say, hey, let me wash the entrances of this. We've got the hot washer. I know where to get. I can get everything he uses at Home Depot.
So, this question here again from Brenda, do you lower your prices a bit during a recession, or do you keep your current price or raise your price? I target mid to high end clients.
Okay. So, if you're not raising your prices 5 or 6 times a year right now, you probably are losing, because I go to places to buy supplies and materials that actually say, we don't guarantee our online prices.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because they don't know a lot of times, especially decking material that we deal with all the time, they don't know till the damn truck pulls in what's actually coming in and what the price is going to be. So yeah, they have to adjust the pricing. Prices, because of the supply chain issue, is a different thing than the other things, recession, inflation, all the other stuff we're talking
about. There's raw materials that these guys, Banjo Fittings, great example. Banjo Fittings just came to us and said, hey, we're going to have an increase. We don't know what it's going to be until they're actually made and delivered to you.
Yep.
Okay. You know, this is one of those things where we've talked about in the past, where your attitude and your belief in yourself and in your prices, I think this is, honestly, this is where I think most people go wrong in pricing. And that is, if you're not confident in your own price, your customers are going to see that as well. And so for me, if I'm worried about raising my prices, then I'm not confident in where I'm at already anyhow. and I need to get myself to that comfort zone. And a lot of this, even like Everett saying, I mean, if you can't afford to go on vacation, you've got a pricing issue. You don't necessarily, you may have a customer issue as well, but that maybe that's because you're going after the wrong customers. You should be able to confidently say, yeah, that's $20 million for me to do that. Whatever your price happens to be, that's what it is.
So it could also be a business model one, though, too. So just to, because I'll talk about the Chuck and the trucks, too, because it depends on what you are. When you try to be everything to everybody, that's a recipe for failure. But I had a guy, I tell a true story now. The guy from Long Island in the class a few years back, and his deal is, it was $149 for 45 minutes, and he'll wash for 45 minutes, okay? That's it. He allows 15 minutes for drive time on each job. They do 12 to 16 homes a day and whatever else, but 12 to 16 homes. If it gets to 45 and you still have a side to the house, he leaves, he goes to the next one. He doesn't do that. He doesn't call and reschedule another 45 minutes. And if they don't have 45 minutes, then tell them to bring out some outdoor furniture or something. And that's his model. $149, 45 minutes, and he sticks to it. But that's who he is. So his business model is more on, you know, the cheaper pricing, the skim pricing, and he's the Walmart.
But you also, you know, I'm not a place for Walmart. You do that eight hours a day, and guess what? You know,
you can put as many crews on and do that if you're and maybe you do it for $199 now. I don't know what it is, but I'm just saying. That's his business model. It worked for that guy. He's and he did that to compete with a guy like me who has premium pricing.
So, but that's always the wrong way to look at it. He can't compete with you on that different pricing. It's impossible.
But that's also why McDonald's and Ruth Chris Steakhouse are in business.
Exactly. Right? I mean, he's not competing with you, but that's not saying that his shit isn't a way to do it, you know?
So, and there's lots of guys out there doing $99 house washes or $99 deck staining or whatever, and they're making a killing. They're working way more than they need to, but at the same time, it is their business model. And if they're doing their business model correctly and they're being profitable, great. I mean, but that's not the business model I want.
The cheap guys have a place in the market too. I used to always say the cheap guys are great because I it was someplace I could
take the customers
I didn't want to. You know, hey, you ought to call this guy because I don't want you as a customer out there. And it's not saying they're not making money at it because, I mean, like I said, you do 8 hours a day at $150 an hour per crew. It's, you're $1,200 right there, if my math is correct, or somewhere around there. Let's address this by Brenda, though, because I have a feeling I know what you're going to say on there.
I think she missed the price list, though.
Yeah, she did. I mean, because so we already established Brenda came in late, but again, yeah. Brenda, I mean, what Everett's doing is literally saying, okay, transparent or CEO, clean seal transparent, seal semi, seal solid.
Then, but are you still doing that per square foot? I guess would be her question.
I do it per square foot. So yes. Let's just say you made a price list and it was $2 a square foot to clean and seal. $250 might be clean and a semi transparent, $3 for a solid. Then what happens? I add sand in that, and maybe I make that $250, $3, and $350.
And so then also, you're also going to be adding in if it's a one-story deck, a two-story deck, or a three-story.
Going there. So even though you have a square footage price, that's what I mentioned before. Was does anybody ever ask when somebody asks about price? Well, how high is the deck off the ground? Because if a deck is right on the ground, that's one thing. But even if it's 3 or 4 feet off the ground and you can't reach the top of the railing, you're still going up and down a ladder all the way around the deck, or you have to have an extension on your spray, your wand, whatever it is. But I mean, every time there's height on it, you should add that. I mean, I used to do insulation when I was 18 years old. You got paid for height work. Mm-hmm. It's no different. You charge more for height work. So you have to have an hourly charge. If you have decorative balusters, if you have, you know, a koi pond and the Japanese maples and all the other stuff around, and a lot of nice landscape and you have to protect and be, you know, real particular around. There's a lot of reason there for hourly charges. So even though you have a base square footage price, you have to look at each job. And unfortunately, this part comes with experience. You say, okay, this is going to take four extra man hours on this job, or six extra man hours. And then you times that times your $150 or $200 or whatever the hell you're charging per hour. And then you don't lose money. I think the other thing too, though, is we have a bad philosophy when we look at some of the things that we do when we price. And this might rank, this will get a few comments going. But a lot of times we look at pricing and we're thinking the we want to get the job. But every time we do that, where's the money? Coming out of our pockets, coming right. out, we're the last as a business owner to get paid. The company's the last one to get paid. I don't think we take that personally enough. And I'll actually tell my customers, ready for this? My customers will say, well, can you take a couple bucks off? How about $100? Or, you know, is there any way you can come down on the price? And mind you, if this is a new customer asking me to do this, how, I don't understand this part. I build my company on maintenance. I want repeat people. There's people that are helping me pay all my bills on a weekly, monthly, yearly basis that keep coming back to me. If I was ever going to discount somebody, shouldn't I discount the people that have been paying my bills all along? Why am I going to discount
this person? Absolutely.
Just walk through the door, $100. And I'll tell the customer that. I'll say, look, I really love to discount people. I mean, hey, who wouldn't take a discount? But if I give you $100 off this job, I got to go back to my office, go over 30 years of customers and send them all a check for $100. I think I hope discount the repeat customers, not the
100%. 100%. Absolutely. And I hope my mic wasn't on because I had to go use the restroom. So, but that's why I removed myself. You know, I could hear y'all talking, and what maybe one of the things where, you know, if you're concerned about the masking and draping, you know, you have a nebulous pricing part on that, you know, masking, draping charged at, you know, per at cost or at current labor rates or something. So you don't say so you can, I don't want to say slip extra charges in there because that sounds not honest, but there's a way to make those prices, you know, go up from the base prices if there's extra work like you were talking about, if it's at height, if it's great example. Back 3 years ago, whenever I was competing for this Florida State bid, which, you know, has wound up being a $400,000 a year, you know, plus contract for our company or my old company that was now, you know, been purchased. But to give an example on that, there was a large building that was washed. And I remember posting pictures in the academy about 3 years ago. And somebody came on Spray Wash Academy going, God, I can't believe, you know, I bid on that FSU contract. And you know, you beat because you were lowball. I can't believe you're doing that building for $7,000. I literally posted on that thread, well, that's funny because here's the invoice. It's $14,000 is what we're doing that building for. Well, how can you do that? It was $8 a foot or let's say 14,000 foot. It was, you know, whatever it was. It was, you know, whatever percent you had. And I said, right. But we also had an added bump in there for dirtiness level. If it was dirtiness level 1, 2, or 3, the price goes up per square foot. Also, access level, the price goes up per square foot. And we had some things in there that would actually triple our prices on there, not just double them. And he said, well, to me, if something's dirty, it's just dirty. That's why I priced it at what I did, you know? Well, that's also why I'm pulling in $400,000 a year from that account now, and you are not, because there's stuff that I can wash for 10 cents a square foot whenever I'm sitting here on the ground and going, okay, yeah, that's great. Yeah. But then whenever I have to hire a $1,200 a day crane or, you know, lift on there or need to turn up the bleach a little bit, but it's always of padding my fee that I'm getting for this by putting the add-ons on that property. Not to mention, we made some little extra stuff in there for window washing, which you might have forgotten to do. We make there's extras in there you can always work to a price list.
So a little twist here, a little change in direction a little bit. Everett, what would you say is one of the best things you've done for you, for your business, to take your business to the next level and to grow to where you're at today?
Well, that's interesting. So the name of my company was not Deck Restoration Plus when I first started. It was Jet Pressure Washing and Window Cleaning. Okay, so when I decided to do that, there was a reason I was doing that. I knew the restoration prices were higher than a lot of the pressure washing a house or whatever, or window cleaning. So what I wanted to do was kind of be able to do, you had alluded to in the pre-game or even when we were talking about packages a couple times. One of the things I wanted to be able to do was simply this. If I have a $2,500 deck restoration job, and I could go up to somebody and say, okay, I'll do your house with the deck for $200. And they're like, holy, $200, that's great, I'll take it. But they didn't know that it was actually a $500 house, but I made the deck $2,800. I can hide it and think they got a discount for the couple $100 or a few $100 off the house, and I'm still charging the same thing for the whole thing. You can't do that. I can't hide decks in the home. So it was something I was struggling with, the business model. So I changed the business model to be able to do that. And once I did, it was easier to do a lot of the other things we did too, including the deck building and some of the other prices. But we kind of look at that as a different service altogether.
And that's a good, that even Eric and Lisa, they did the same thing. I don't want to say that they were struggling. I don't want to suggest that at all, but I think that they were having, I don't even know if problems in their business model is the correct way, but they were started off as what A&E, pressure washing or something to that nature. And then they rebranded and became Liberty Softwash. So it more defined who they were and what they did. And I think getting away from the word pressure washing was important. And just like you're saying, DRP, Deck Restorations Plus. So it's not deck repair. It's not deck cleaning. It's not deck soft. It's restoration. And that plus already commands a higher price. Yeah. Everybody knows, you know, if you have to restore something, there's a cost to that that is much higher than a repair or even building something brand new. Sometimes there's a premium price that comes with restoration.
100%. I want to bounce on a couple of questions too. Sure. Big Rob, second season, first season charged by square foot. This season I'm charging by time. Thoughts on what's better? Time, 100%. Depending on what you're washing, I mean, depending on what you're doing, I mean, square footage is important, but for the actual washing part, to me, it was always a time issue.
So going back to Rob, if he's doing pressure washing, I go with the same thing. If he's doing wood, though, one of the things you want to do, I think a lot of guys mess this up because they try to price by linear feet and all this other stuff. You need to convert everything to a square footage for two reasons. So you might as well do the price that way too. But the big thing is, if you're sealing, staining, or coating these jobs, there is a yield on every manufacturer's product that is by the square foot. Mm-hmm. You want to take the guesswork out and know about how much you should be putting on. So if you're supposed to be putting 10 gallons on a job, you better put 10 gallons if it's supposed to last for 2 years. Because if you put more than that, you're losing money. If you give guys, you're guessing, you say, okay, guys, take these 3 pails, even though it's supposed to be taken, they're going to use the 15.
Right.
And then if you're short, then guess what? It's not going to hold up for 2 years because you didn't file the manual.
You didn't put it on and take it up. Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, when it comes to wood and coating, cover your square, get your square footage, get a price, and it'll take the guesswork out. Another thing it'll do, it'll keep your stock down. You won't have leftover cans, you know, all over the place because you'll have very minimal.
If you have your square footage pricing set in place and you have the parameters that we've been talking about, right? Like even you had said, you know, the dirtiness level goes up, you know, it takes it up that next level. You can take that and say, I've got 10 square feet. It's 10 cents. You know what that is now. Okay. If it's got lichens on it, it's 11 cents. Yep. If it's three stories,
these are the things that we can, these are the add-ons. These are the add-on dirtiness levels that we can boost our square footage by, because let's face it, if I want to do a roof price, could you wash a roof for 15 cents a square and come out? Yeah, you could. Could you wash a fern roof for 15 cents a square foot and come out? No. I mean, Doug, you're from fern country too. Mm-hmm. Could you? No, I mean, now all of a sudden we do an add-on for ferns up there. I mean, the same way with decks.
Well, absolutely. You know, and even like you're saying with ferns, I mean, we have had a very strict structure on how
fern. We had a very specific fern policy.
Yeah. I mean, and we, you know, if we have to, we'll get up there with scissors and we'll trim them off, you know, because we didn't want to pull the roots out. Then we're going to kill it. Then we're going to come back. I think we had a three-step policy with ferns. I mean, and you got to charge accordingly for that.
So Pro Wash is asking, can we start over, please? But
hey, being how he's bringing it up, DRP products has made me a ton of money over the last few years. Thanks, Everett. So for those of you that also don't know, Everett also sells products. Tell us a little bit about the products.
Didn't even talk about it. Yeah, and I see Steve Sally on here doing that.
Yeah, Steve, I wanted to give a shout out to Steve. I mean, I love Steve is one of my favorite people. I love him.
Steve does a lot of he's PA Softwash. He does a lot of roofs and stuff. He uses our products, and really appreciate him too, and these guys. But we have our products. So about 20 some years ago plus, I was working with the Joint Coatings Committee, part of the Forest Products Lab, and the big thing was there's going to be no oils. Back in the time, give a shout out to Ready Seal. All of us were using Ready Seal as a contractor grade. There really was nothing else. And I'm thinking, okay, oils are going to go away, but I like the characteristics of it. It was easy to maintain. It lasted a couple of years and so forth. Now, no comment about the product today. I'm just talking about moving forward from there. I tried to come up with a product that was similar in a lot of the characteristics, but be it a water base. And I wanted to come up with something that would penetrate and go in the wood. I know people still say to this day, yeah, it's a water base. He's got a film former. It's not a film former. Anybody who's used it knows it's not. Yeah, a lot of great guys using it. They send me pictures all the time. Then you get those comments that they had. It really goes in. It wears away in a couple of years. It starts to wear away and you replenish it just like you do the contractor grade oils. It's really worked out well. And then on top of that, I really believe I do this all the time. 30 years I'm doing this. I don't want to be aggravated. I don't want to be frustrated. I want good products. I'm selfish. If it works for me first, then it works. Then I'll sell it to somebody. But if it's not working for me, I'm not going to use it. So we have two different strippers. We do a stripper for film forming coatings and penetrating coatings. We have restorers. We have all kinds of products that I think have gone to the next level in this market. I think too many times people say, I use bleach to clean with, I use sodium hydroxide to strip with. Well, if that's what you're doing, guess what? You're a dinosaur and you're out of the freaking industry pretty quick anyway, because there's so much more today than just those two products that deliver quality results. And the way the coating game has changed between water, oil, hybrids, the use of emulsification, and some of the other stuff that's used in this industry, you need to have more products or at least be knowledgeable of them so that when you need them, you can use them. And I believe that's what I've come up with my company and the products we have.
Mm-hmm. I love this. Truth said, I hate staining. I used to hate staining decks as a painter, so I raised the price until I enjoyed it. It really works.
Now that's truth for real. Yeah.
That is truth. Truth Seeker. Well, I got to admit, Truth Seeker throws out some good truth sometimes.
He really does. He really, really does. You know, and Pro Wash there, wouldn't touch wood, long hours with Jim Bob. And you, 80% of his income. So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Somebody knows the wizard title. Looks like we got David Rivas here. How are you doing square foot for spindles? Spindles is what kills me in time.
Okay, so it's real easy for this too. So I prescribe to the keep it simple, stupid method, or as other people call it, the KISS method. So what I do is, ready for this? This is going to be the hardest thing you've ever done. So most of the railings will say feet high. People never count the fascia. So they're 36 to 42 inches, but we never count the fascia. So basically what I do is I take my linear footage, and let's say it's a 20 by 30 deck. That's 20 on one side, 20 on one side, 30 on the other. Just an example, not counting the stairs or anything else. That gives me 70 feet times 4 feet high, 280. Okay. Now I double it because there's two sides. That's 560. Now I add that to my 600 square foot floor and it's 1160 square feet. Now, how do I come up with that? Ready for this? anybody who knows building codes, the balusters, spindles, or pickets, depending on where you are in this country. And for you Carolina people, you're welcome. I use the word pickets. Anyway, they're 4-inch centers. About how many inches on each side of a spindle?
That's one inch on each side. Yeah, it's a one inch.
But let's just treat it as a solid piece.
Yeah.
Pretty simple. That's why I say it's pretty simple. But I got guys that say, I count the spindles and charge $1 a spindle.
Well, you're losing money at that point.
You're losing money wasting the time counting.
Yeah, you're losing money counting it.
Christmas. And if you do linear footage and you're doing a price, then you don't really get the square footage. But I got it better even for this, for the fences. Ready for this one? What's the typical size of a fence?
What, 6 foot?
6 foot by eight.
Yeah.
48, right?
How many panels? Yeah.
The other panels, the other side, if you do two sides, is 96.
Yeah.
Didn't even count the posts. Let's call it, keep it simple, stupid. 50 and 100. I got guys with their wheels going around the backyard. Me, I look at it and go, 32 panels. Okay, got my 3,200 square feet. Come up with a price.
Yeah.
Keep it simple.
It's true.
Everything's square footage.
Mm-hmm. So Burke has a question here. I have an estimate due tomorrow. A school district that needs pressure washing in a five-year contract. Not sure what they want to clean. It's about eight school buildings. Want an hourly price versus a price it out per building, et cetera. How would you bid something like this? They want a superior to be looking at each project. Well, I mean, you know, if you've got it, if you want a price per building, you need to be out there looking per building on there. And then also what's your operating, you know, as far as an hourly price, what's your price to operate per hour, Burke? I mean, that's.
And let's be clear on what they're actually probably asking here. Let me throw that probably out there. What they're probably asking for, they're not asking for two separate prices. They're asking for a price to clean those buildings, and then they're asking for an hourly price for anything that isn't on, that isn't included in whatever it is that you're bidding on. So you might say that I'm going to clean that building for, you know, $2,500, and then my hourly rate is $250 per hour, right? So that they, it helps them gauge on if they want extra work in the future, or they're trying to preset a defined rate so that they don't get any surprises later on. That's generally what that's about. It's not about, hey, give me a price if we do it by the hour, or a price on the building by itself. They're not looking for that same price against that one item.
But if they are looking for an hourly price, I mean, we'll certainly give them that. But that's where, you know, as we always talk about, why it's so important to know your numbers, mm-hmm. to know what your business cost you to run, to know, you know, I know that if I send a truck out there and I'm only making $95 an hour, I'm officially losing money because I've got one guy on that truck at $18 an hour. I've got a crew leader on that truck at $25 an hour. I know that bleach and gas are going to cost me $40 a day on there. I can't afford to operate it at $95 an hour on there. So I'm really going to want to be at $200 to $225 an hour on there. And I think that's a fair price, especially for a commercial or governmental entity like a school board.
And that takes out the equation of using a change order because you've already got it in place in the original contract.
That's true.
By the way, another thing a lot of contractors don't use is change orders.
Yeah. And I want to go and hold on. Brenda had a great comment here. Trying to agree with the guys restoring a teak deck 740 foot for $5,000 because of the third story, no access, rubber roofing underneath, no area to push cleaners off the side and not down the sewer. Every one of those things that she mentioned added on to the difficulty of that, you know.
Yeah,
awesome, Brenda. Right. You are incredible. Yep.
And there's nothing wrong with bragging about that.
Not at all. Not at all.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Somebody just turned some magenta pigment a different color. Oh, Brenda's drinking tequila. Good for you, Brenda.
So that issue with the a lot of people are tying the paint issue to the pandemic, too. That was way before the pandemic started. They started trying to cut costs and buying those overseas pigments that were doing that. And the funny thing is, when I first heard about it, I remember having conversations before all the people involved today with like Bo or somebody.
Yeah.
But if you want to know what Sherwin-Williams is doing, you know who you ask? Not Sherwin-Williams. Benjamin Moore.
Yeah, they know what Sherwin-Williams is doing.
And vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you kind of get answers, because otherwise they're just going to tell you what they want to tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
Well, and quite frankly, they don't, depending on who you talk to, like going back to Sherwin-Williams, if you ask the local reps, you're going to get a different answer a lot of times, even amongst the reps, because I don't know that they're trained to deal with, or they're still of the mindset of, you know, this is how you do it. And they're not necessarily even following their own procedures anymore because they don't know them.
When this started, and again, I'm going back probably 5 years at least. When you went on a Sherwin-Williams, and probably was still there 3 years ago, when you went on Sherwin-Williams website, you literally could see a place where it said, don't use bleach. Mm-hmm. And another spot where it said, use bleach in a test spot.
Yeah.
I mean, it just didn't make sense from the beginning.
Yeah, I can pull up Sherwin-Williams for whenever. When did we write plant and property protection, Doug? That page on Sherwin-Williams, 2017 or so, 16. Yeah. And it's still, that same page is still up there where it says, hey, the way to wash Sherwin-Williams is bleach.
And that was directly from the Sherwin-Williams site.
Yeah, directly from them. Well, so.
But on the other side of it, now when we look at it from manufacturer's side, whether it be Sherwin-Williams, the composite deck builders, all these things, a lot of the things what they do, a lot of places where they get a lot of their information from is by literally coming into our Facebook groups. I know these contractors do not want to own it, but they talk a lot of shit and they've heard a lot of people in this industry just by thinking, hey, I want to answer this question, even though I don't know what I'm talking about or whatever else. They talk out their ass and it's pissed me off many times. Now I just got on a soapbox because I've talked to the manufacturers and they tell me that they go in there and they see 100% bleach, 50-50, nuke it, you know, flames.
Oh, yeah.
50-50, spray everything at 50-50. That's what I do. Spray it at 50-50. Yeah, turn that dial up. Yeah, that's what you got to do.
And then the worst part about it is they'll come out with a recommendation for household bleach. What are we using?
We're not using household bleach, are we?
12 and a half. So they sit there and go, okay, well, if I'm going to guarantee this product for 25 or 30 years or 10 years on a paint or stain or whatever the hell it is, a solid stain, then that's what they're looking at. And then they adjust accordingly. Now, all of a sudden, instead of being able to use bleach responsibly, like a lot of us do, they're saying no bleach and then we're screwed.
Yeah. They blanket saying no bleach on there. Do you know it benefits them to say that as well? Well, do you know how many times that I have, and you know, this is one of the things in Spray Wash Pro that we have where we've got from JM Roofing, where we've got from GAF, where roofers have told us no bleach. And I have literally got letters and engineer contacts in there where we've got it, where they said, no, you actually sound responsible, like you're not a freaking moron. And I'm paraphrasing here, but you're welcome to use bleach at this percentage and that, even though our technical specifications say don't use bleach on there, because they realize that I'm not some yahoo out here slinging 50-50, 12.5% like a dumbass.
Yeah, we've been saying it for quite some time that they are in the groups. And if you're posting the pictures, it's the same thing with, I mean, I'm going to say DOT and OSHA and everybody else. I'm sure they have reps in the groups and they are, if they're in your area, I mean, I'm sure that they're looking for you going, okay, yeah, that's one of them guys.
You know? So I want to, by the way, I mentioned this, I did a little slow pitch about the stuff we had in Spray Wash Pro. Everett, there's also something else in Spray Wash Pro that we have, and I believe it ties in directly to you. What is that?
It does. We have our wood restoration course in Spray Wash Pro, and it was designed, and I believe it's the best education that's out there online. Mm-hmm. We constantly also keep that up. If there's new species, new something, we've kept it up over the years. Mm-hmm. And you have the latest and greatest of the class. And it's for, you know, people want to use it for employees, for the business, whatever. There's a lot of information in there, and it will definitely take you to the next level. And I've noticed one thing over the last few years, more people are doing online courses than they are the hands-on and coming to the classes. And, you know, it could have been pandemic and other things too.
Right. Absolutely.
People have, it's a lot of people going to the online classes. And I think That gives you a really good starting place too, but for one. But it also, if you've been doing this for a year or two, a couple of years, you're still in stuff in there you're going to learn because it's been adjusted to today's times and not something you're getting that was done from 10 years ago, 15 years ago, and still being taught.
Well, do you know how impressive it is to literally look at a customer and say, I took a course from DRP. I took a course from Spray Wash Pro. Do you know how few contractors will ever mention that they took a class or a course from anywhere?
That they're certified in something or that they've done something?
Yeah.
Ready for this? Chris Collins and Shelby Collins down in Georgia. You guys may have heard of them. They do quite a bit. And I've had two people tell me this now, but they were doing some historic homes and to bid that, they asked them, do you know who the Wizard of Wood is?
Nice.
And Chris takes out his cell phone and says, would you like me to call him?
Yep. I love that.
They wanted the homes done the way I teach, either on the YouTube videos or in the courses. So nice. It does get around. And then I can tell you another thing, too. This course that you have, I broke the news last week. It's going to be on the NADRA, the North American Deck and Railing Association, on their site. They're top in theirs as well. And that's a pretty big endorsement for the course to teach people that are deck building as well. And you guys have that course. Mm-hmm. So,
wow.
It's out there.
That's a hell of an endorsement right there.
Yeah, yep. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. I mean, it is funny that if for people that don't think that, like, you know, the certifications, we always say that, you know, they don't mean anything if you don't use them. You have to use them, right? But on the other side of that coin, in today's day and age, everything is so right there in front of every single customer. If you think that they haven't already checked you out, they haven't already been to your website, they haven't already seen your reviews, if you're kidding yourself, right? So that's why these things are so important nowadays. And that's why these using things like the certifications, where they can then go back and they can look and say, okay, well, what is that about? They're going to do that research on you. The ones that aren't doing that research are the customers, again, that I don't necessarily want anyhow. You know, I want the person that wants a good quality job and they're willing to pay for it.
But you know what David's saying here, the problem with Florida and everywhere else, everyone and they knows how to clean roofs. They splash and dash and leave the customer with the aftermath. 100%. And you know, that's the best customer to ever have is some guy whose landscape was absolutely freaking nuked from the dodo that they did before. This is why I'm an expert witness in two separate trials right now, because the man went online and said, wow, this guy, Ray Burke, he's written a course about the standard of care in pressure washing. I need to talk to him. And there is actually a standard of care that people should be doing out there. Mm-hmm. These are insurance companies suing each other. This isn't like some homeowner going, oh, I'm going to sue the pressure washer. No, these are houses. And in one case, a row of townhouses that were burnt down, actually kind of close to your area, Everett. And there's going to be some hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars in damages out there. And they're pinning it back on the pressure washing company's insurance.
I've had to testify before, and I can tell you one with insurance companies, it was a house that was damaged, sky roofs, over pressure washing, water entered the interior, stained the inside logs, and they took estimates. One was like 280, one was like 340. The other one was 520. They had to take all the furniture out, put them in pods. Then they had to put the people up in hotels. $520,000. Guess which one the claim they went with? They went with the highest one.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah. And you don't have any say so in that. The homeowner has the right to choose whichever repair company they want. As long as it's within reason, they can't be, you know, way out there, but for the most part they can charge, they can choose whomever they want.
Yep.
Mhm.
That's just the way it is.
Steve, education is priceless. The level of comfort I enjoy when I can pick up the phone and talk to Everett and his competent guys on speed dial. After you do wood restoration for a while, you will have even more specific questions and the need for guidance and education.
Thank you, Steve.
Absolutely. Yeah, Steve's such a great guy.
I think that's important, though. And I think that's what's lacking with some of the larger companies is they've kind of forgotten about this support, because support is huge. And when does somebody need support? When they're on the job.
Yeah.
And you have people that can actually do that when they're on the job, correct?
Correct. So if they don't get a hold of me, they can get a hold of the guy, somebody. They're going to get
knows what they're doing.
Yeah. So
not a guy that started his business 2 years ago and is writing books.
I just right.
And I oddly specific, Doug. Oddly specific.
Well, you know, I get my inspiration from PWP.
Yeah.
I like the fact that I wrote my book and my manual that's 152 pages that goes along with the course, and I didn't copy and paste.
Yeah, 30 years, blah, blah, blah. What do you know?
Yeah.
You know what's funny about that? And I love that. But I think that's what keeps me going, too, is a lot of people will say, you know, I've always tried to stay current. And I've done that with the manual and keeping up with the industry right. and so forth. And I think that's why I've been successful. I'm not still stuck 20 years ago.
Right.
And I think that's what keeps these classes relevant and so forth. And I think with these changes, and I think that's a big reason why these online courses and the education is huge. The other thing, too, is that it does, besides giving you the good education, if I'm building something, and let's face it, when we start, we're building a company, right? How many people build these damn businesses without building the foundation?
Absolutely.
And
God had something to say about that, about the whole shifting sands and the solid rock, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. If you don't put in, we talk about that so continuously about the foundation of your business, and you have to build it as a solid foundation. Otherwise, everything eventually it will crumble.
Not to toot our own horns. That's why plant and property protection mm-hmm. keeps getting added to, you know, every 6 months or so. Area, it's like, yeah. Oh, wow, there's new stuff we need to put in here because mm-hmm. it'll never
be finished because things are changing.
It's always changing.
That's one of the things. I mean, we can talk about this forever, but when you look at it and look, we're all old codgers, right? And a lot of times the old codgers will sit there and say, I've been doing this for 30 years and you're not changing me and telling me different. You know, but that's the whole point of it, right? I don't care that we're, you know, I don't care how long you've been at it. You have to understand that things change. 30 years ago, I had a beeper. I didn't have a cell phone. Things change. 30 years ago, I couldn't pick up my phone and scroll through pictures and, you know, all that kind of stuff. I didn't have Facebook, right? Things change. And even in the wash industry, things are changing and there's new advancements. There's new stains. There's new things that react with bleach. I mean, all these different things. And doesn't matter how old you are, you need to adapt and change with the times.
And yeah, you know, let me give a caveat to that too. But also things change for the worse. Also, I just want to point this out. You know, about 5 years ago, everybody now that says the gas roof pumps are the shit. You know, that's, oh God, gas roof pumps. That's the thing. You know, 5 years ago, they were all but dead and gone. Gas roof pumps were dead. And then all of a sudden, some guy gets on there and he gets a Facebook group with a bunch of people on there. And he starts talking about, hey, look how fast I can wash this house. I'm here in 15 minutes. Oh, my God. Look at here. That was $150 in 15 minutes. And now all of a sudden we've had the resurgence of gas roof pumps up there, where most of the old school washers knew that gas roof pumps were absolute crap. Some guys love them. By all means, if you do, I don't mean offense by this, but there's so many new guys that don't understand. If you're an old guy and you have a gas roof pump, you also know you've got a freaking backup gas roof pump, or a backup head at least, or several repair kits on there, because you know they're going to crap out on you.
Yeah. You know, it's really, I think what it comes down to is there should be a mutual respect between the younger guys in the industry and the older ones, because we can both learn from each other. I love
absolutely the
perspective I get from new people. I've learned things in an interview with somebody who hasn't even worked for me or started working for me yet, just from a different perspective. So I always appreciate that. Mm-hmm. But I think the give and take, discounting people because of being older or younger, I think is not the right?
100%. I mean, the younger guys understand technology better than I ever will. And I still remember one of the groups, and I got famously kicked out of that group because they were going, yeah, man, we're young. We're cool. We don't want these old guys in here telling us how to do stuff. Yeah. I'm like, well, you're a bunch of freaking idiots if you don't actually want guys with experience in there telling you how to do stuff. Now, granted, probably every one of the people in that group knows more about the interweb than I ever will, mm-hmm. but I guarantee you, I know more about Bleach than 99.99999% of them do. I love Steve. Yes, yeah. Solar booster pump. Do it.
There you go.
Well, so look, I mean, we all love Steve, but let's come out with the reality about Steve too. And Steve is also the one that invented the hamster wheel booster. So, you know, we got to, at least he's moving towards solar now, right?
That's great. That is great.
I love Steve.
Oh, man.
You know what's funny too? We talk about things being different and so forth. You know what? Talking about old guys, young guys, things coming around, cyclical things. I think some of you said things don't always change for the better. An interesting thing I have found out between everybody automating everything, we've lost the personal touch.
Oh, yeah. God. 100% Everett. And people, our customers actually crave that. I mean, people are, yes. Oh, my God, you're going to come out and talk to me? Well, yeah. Everybody gives me bids online. Everybody does this.
The phone and talk. Actually, they hear a voice. They're like, oh, my God, somebody picked up the phone. It's you. Yeah. You're already different than your competitors.
Absolutely. 100%. We have lost. I have a very, very good friend of mine, and he's a mentor of mine, and I'm a mentor of his, I guess, maybe I'm, but I remember about 3 years ago, maybe 2 years, 3 years ago, he called me and he said, man, I am stuck in a rut and I'm having a problem right now. And he was promoting a certain software at that point. A software that did a lot of your follow-ups for you, that responsibly did a lot of follow-ups every time you did a bid. So I said, people may have picked up on that or not. And I said, Fred, can I tell you what I see from your online persona and what I know about you and you talking about this bid this software that talks about responsible bids and then bids them out for you. You're letting the computer do your work. You are being a slave to technology on here, and you're not actually picking up the phone like your very personable self would typically do in years past. And you're letting this software go and do that for you. And sure enough, about 2 months later, we were talking. He's like, I'm back. And you were right. You know, and while I'm not going to discount this software that I was using, I was relying too much on technology doing this because I thought that this new software was latest and greatest. And I was letting it essentially bug people every day going, hey, you haven't chosen our bid yet. Hey, are you still wanting software? Are you still wanting soft washing? Are you still wanting your roof clean? Sending out, you know, emails. Hey, remember to check on your bid here. Instead of the personal touch of, hey, this is Fred with Fred's window cleaning. Did you check out that bid that I sent you yet?
I'm going to go a slightly different direction. We're three old codgers, and I think we all believe the same thing. Customer service is key. Picking up the phone, answering the phone, you know, going out and actually doing those bids. But the same thing that we were just talking about, right? We have to look at the new generation. And there are a lot of people out there in today's society that don't necessarily want to talk to us, don't necessarily want to meet with us, don't necessarily care about being there when we're there and want that level of service that is different than what we want, right? So they want those follow-ups. They want to do everything by text and by email and by, you know, Facebook and whatever that kind of thing is. So again, that falls back into knowing who your customer is, because they're making money just like we are off of, you know, getting higher end clients, because we're getting higher end clients by personally going in, shaking hands and doing things. They're getting them by doing, you know, responsible bidding type stuff. Right. So we got to keep in mind that there are, there is more than one way to skin that exact same, that exact same
And to answer this question, I will damn sure go to court. I know who this is. I will damn sure go to court with you and defend and can show where you are very competent. So 100%.
Go ahead, Everett. You were going to say something?
I forgot because I started reading that.
Oh, sorry.
Then it went away while I was reading it.
It says, Ray, you want to go to court with me? Plant damage 30 days after services. Gotta love. Summers in Florida, took picks 10 days after services with a few brown leaves on a shrub, possibly from us, but most likely just summer heat and drought. Customer didn't want anything done at that time, but now we ruined everything. Smack my head, Gene.
We all have those.
No, G, not Gene.
So, G. Yeah. Everett, go ahead, and then I'll throw my two cents.
You know, we have customers like that. And that kind of ties into what you're saying about the in-person part. Those people that just want to do by text or CRM or whatever, I'll entice them in, but I'm still going to encourage the interaction because I'm still trying for maintenance. Mm-hmm. So I'll do things, even though they want to be dealt with text, email, whatever the hell it is, it's impersonal. We are going to do some crazy things. Even at the end, when we leave a bill, we leave a citronella candle because we know they're going to be out on that deck. It has our logo on it, but it's a citronella candle. It keeps the bugs away. We leave a gift. Today, we also leave a bag that says our name of our company on it because there's no more plastic bags. So we're leaving the bags. And that's a huge one. I've actually been in the supermarket and stole one of my bags. So
that's a great idea, Everett.
Now we've encouraged the interaction. So maybe it started out as a text relationship,
right?
But it evolves into more of that. Mm-hmm. And I want to convert those people over because I don't want to continue to be that text person. I want to be different and encourage that moving forward.
I have a very good friend that I talk to every other day, if not daily. And talked the other day, he said, you know, within 5 years, I want to be out of the service business. I said, why? He said, because it just came to me that the idiots and nincompoops that we're dealing with nowadays, as far as our employees, are going to become homeowners and property managers and the people who hire us. Could you imagine working with these idiots in 5 years? And he has a very valid point.
Got a better one for you. How about in 5 to 10 years, all the people on TikTok that are going to be our customers?
That's the point of where he was going.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
Hey, I want to go back one, Ray. Okay. So just so you know, I had one where the guy went after me, suing me for 4 months. Damage to his property 4 months after we left. And it was right after record freezing in Baton Rouge. We don't freeze here, you know, hardly ever. We had two back-to-back record freezes in Baton Rouge where his plants died, and it all of a sudden became my fault. There was also some concrete damage he was blaming me for. We had before and after pictures of everything.
Alligator scaling that you can see under, yeah.
Yeah, and the way that ended out was the insurance company settled with him, gave him a very large chunk of money, even though we could prove everything, right? And then they came back to me and said, we want to check from you for... You know, I think they wanted like $4,500 because I had originally said, hey, if the guy just came to me, I'd have given him his money back, you know, even though it wasn't my fault. I just wanted it to go away kind of a thing. And so they said, okay, well, give us a check for the $4,500. I said, no, there's no way I would settle that deal. I mean, my deductible is $250. I'll give you the $250 and that's it. You settled. I didn't. He was wrong. I wasn't, period. End of story. So, just know that doesn't necessarily matter. You can fight them tooth and nail, but a lot of them, the insurance companies have the final say. So,
on here and tick clock. Yeah, don't try to pay in lap dances. Yeah, true. What is alligator scaling? Alligator scaling is where the it's broken, and it's just the lay of the concrete of how it looks, but the customer couldn't see it because it was so dark and gross and black on top of it. It was literally the pour of the concrete and how it looked.
Hey, Doug, I forgot Louisiana. You know what a lot of the guys, a lot of your good old boys do down there with wood homes and stuff like that? What they restore the wood with?
Probably sodium hydroxide.
Drain motor oil.
What?
Yeah, they save the motor oil.
We used to do that. We used to do that on my parents and grandparents did that on the farm. And anytime you ever sunk a piece of wood into the ground,
restore it. They restore it.
Yeah.
It's drain motor oil. It's crazy, but we used
it works
to the farm too. But I've had people call me and say, "Yeah, I just use the drain motor oil. Keeps my house looking good, protected,
and keeps the bug."
Yeah, and damn sure it keeps the termites from getting in the wood too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
It's funny the things you pick up geographically all over the country. I've been to all these places, and it's funny. There's a little niche here, niche there, niche everywhere. People that do different things. It's pretty neat.
That is. Mr. Charlie, you're getting here, and we're almost an hour and a half into it. See how you are.
What's up, Charlie? How are you? Charlie,
Charlie,
I hear you're going to be speaking. Congratulations.
Yep.
Absolutely. Charlie and his wife will bring a wealth of knowledge. And God, if you have never met Charlie, his wife, and his family, his two beautiful children, I mean, that those kids stick their hands out and shake your hand. Yep. And oh, my God, they're just amazing, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like you sit there and go, I wish my kid was this well-mannered.
Well, you know what, too? The thing about, like, listen to try, and I'm not trying to, like, you know, rain on somebody's parade, but when I think of people I want to listen to, I don't want to be around the thousandaires. I want to be around the people that can make me better. Mm-hmm. I want to be around the people who have survived the industry, been through 2009, been through things. I want to learn from these people. Hey, what got you, you know, through certain things? Charlie's one of those guys who's been around for a while. If you can't listen to him and learn something, you got issues.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people don't realize, I mean, Charlie uses virtual assistants. Charlie actually goes offshore for some of his virtual assistants, people that speak absolutely perfect, you know, English out there. He and his wife are working. They're schooling their kids, and they've got offices that may not be in America. But you would never know that, but that phone is always answered and they're very much a part of his team. In fact, they're family. And it just shows you that you don't have to sit here. You can, I know it's an overused thing, but think outside of the box kind of thing, you know, I mean, and they do, and gosh, they're amazing.
When I was younger, I played basketball. And I always wanted to play on a court with the better guys, the older guys. I love, you know, five on, five off. You win, you keep playing, that kind of thing. Played a lot of street ball. You always play with people that were better than you to make you do better. And that's what I think a philosophy in business should work, too. And even the technical stuff, how to run your business, I want to be around those people. I see a lot of names come up that I've known over the years. They're speaking at the different events. And I think that's pretty cool. But I will say this, and I don't mean to rain on anybody's parade again, but some of you guys, stop going to the events. We don't need serial event people. I mean, there's a lot of factions, a lot of events, a lot of groups. I get that. But run your business first.
Yeah.
Run your business. Use Spray Wash Pro and take your classes. And
you know, I love you talking about that. When we were younger, we used to play basketball. Now we're older, we look like basketballs.
I resemble that.
There you go.
Charlie's just getting on. You're going to have to tell the story about the big bull and the little bull again.
Hold on, look at that. Jacob Deal. Mr. Jacob Deal. He's got you as an autographed Wizard of Wood book. So
there's quite a few of those out there. I've autographed some manuals too. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Lonnie Shook used to bust my stones all the time. He says, nobody asked me to do that stuff.
Sorry, Lonnie, you know.
You know, a funny story about those guys. I don't know if you remember, they came out with sand a couple of years ago, and they came out with the King of Sand, and they would have the King hat. They copied it off the Wizard of Wood shit. He stole it from me. Jeez.
Damn bastards.
I know. Lonnie, I hope you're on here listening.
I actually haven't seen Lonnie in a minute, but
well, they split off the Trident.
Oh, okay. Was that the? Oh, that was yes. Trident.
Yeah.
I can't keep up. There's so much changeover, and we're Deco guys at PWS. So
people selling their businesses and all kinds of stuff.
I love with Mark Tulliano and I've talked with both these guys, and I'll be teaching in Georgia with Mark again coming up in L&H. So Mark and Lonnie are two of the best guys. I know they're both doing the guys that I have ever taught or traveled with doing these things. Two great guys.
Mm-hmm. Mike's here, Mike Kilgore. So now Mike is the SEK. No, Trident. Mike is Trident. Absolutely. Mike's actually an amazing person who got trained together and amazing guy. We just don't carry his product at Power Wash Store.
There's another guy who's been around a while too. And
if a little bit.
You know, learn something from it. There's so much you can learn.
If you can't learn from Mike on sealing, you're not willing to learn. So,
yeah.
I mean, Mike's gone through several different products. He's been through several different, you know, I mean, I would actually say that Mike, you know,
has a very good knowledge of
business. He's changed his business. He's changed his sealing products to, obviously, you know, he's found different things in the market that's worked better, and he's always been willing to adapt and
changing. Right,
it's a fantastic name.
It goes right along with what we were saying about where you have to adapt and change with the times, and that's what he's.
But that's
done.
Also makes him an expert in what he does.
Exactly, but
because he's seen a lot of it and been through those wars and those changes, and that makes a big difference. Really mm-hmm. does.
It does. It does. You know, I mean, stuff change, and like we talked earlier, stuff changes. Stuff changes in this industry. Yep. You know, there's another person like chiming in on Mike. Mike's another one of his mentors. I'm in heaven. Some of my favorite guys in one place.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. Good. Absolutely.
Stuff. And the one thing I like about virtually everybody we're talking about here is that everybody is willing to help and give back, and that to me is such a key important factor that.
Yeah,
it's not just about selling product. Everett, as a matter of fact, let me just throw Everett under the bus here, is that he hasn't been pitching his product at all on here. We've been the ones that have said, hey, you know, he's got a class. Hey, he's got products and all that, because he's willing to give back and do. If you're in that, if you're looking at wood cleaning, or you're looking at getting into the wood space, or if you're already in that space, I definitely encourage you to try, you know, Everett's products. And you know, again, it all boils down to what we do in our business is customer service. And he is absolutely proving that customer service is key to him. And that in and of itself, if I'm looking at two of the exact same products, I'm willing to pay a little bit more for one product than I am for another. Again, if it's the exact same product, based on who it is I'm buying from. And he has a good product.
I think when it comes to stuff like this that I do, and I see the comments, the people that post the stuff for me. I don't need to.
Yeah, you don't need to
say anything. And I've been around long enough. I think I've touched a lot of people over a lot of years.
Okay, Joe Biden.
It's been a lot of fun. And I'm sure those people are telling other people.
Like, yes, they are.
Yeah.
Everett touched me.
I get it. I get it. I felt your hair too. I get it in the mail all the time. Hey, this guy said to check in with you about this. So
I mean, I'll give a pitch out to Mike with Trident. I guarantee you, if you were using Trident Sealer right now, and you needed to get hold of Mike, you could get hold of Mike or somebody from his organization and say, hey, I got a question about this. I mean, if somebody was using, you know, DRP stuff, they could get hold of you or somebody from your organization. If somebody was buying, you know, something from me and said, Ray, I got a question, they may have to leave me a message, and I'll eventually get back to them because it's only me sitting here. But yeah, you will get back on there, you know, versus, hey, I saw one recently, somebody selling a rig that they just all of a sudden changed their mind, and the guys, you know, supposedly backed up with 6 months of back orders, but no, we won't refund your money. You're going to have to find another buyer and take a $3,000-$4,000 loss on this skid that you bought from us. But even though we're supposedly 6 months back ordered on here and prices are going up every day, it's kind of bullshit if you ask me.
Yeah, everything is. No matter. Anyhow.
This is a no BS zone.
Yeah, no BS zone.
Well, we've all been around long enough that we know the truth about a lot of shit, you know?
We don't, yeah.
I'll tell you what, I'd rather have people actually reach out to me through Messenger, text, even my cell phone, you can find Christ anywhere too. But I have a lot of respect for people who reach out for me directly now, then go to the Facebook group and ask.
Yeah.
Because you're going to get 15 different opinions. It's probably going to make you more confused.
You can get 15 opinions, or you can get the right one by just coming to us.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
That surprises me too sometimes. I mean, when you look in some of the groups and somebody asks, okay, how do you do this? Okay, and let's just say, for example, somebody goes in and they say, how do I clean a wood fence? And Everett Abrams jumps in, and they know who Everett is and all of that. And Everett says, do step one, step two, and step three. Okay? Plain black and white. It's there. This is what you do. Then they jump into another group. Okay, well, how do I do this? And then they jump into another group. You're searching for the answer that fits you and not what's
reality. You want the answer you want to hear, not the right answer.
Exactly.
Okay, I'll go even worse. Ready for this? And I had one happen the other day. I showed it to my wife. I said, look at this. And I show her the question. And she said, well, why? What's so big about that? I said, they're not asking for me. That's a question in one of the groups. And what they do is they'll reach out to me for an answer, and then they go answer the question. Happened a lot over there. Yeah.
Or if you answer it in the other group, they'll answer it back with almost the exact same verbiage of what you answered it with. Yeah. Been there, done that, seen that. You're like, really? Okay.
How do I strip solid body stain? Oh shit, Everett. How do I strip solid body stain? You know. Okay, here's how you strip solid body stain. Everett just answered. Yeah, but they leave out Everett just answered.
They used to do that shit on the old bulletin boards, though, too. Yeah. Kind of funny.
It is.
Oh. Well, you know, I'll admit I've done that. I admit it. Okay. But what I do is I'll say, okay, well, I reached out to Everett, and he said do this. And give them the answer based on what I was told, because I don't have that answer. So I'll reach out to somebody that has the correct answer versus, you know, trying to make it up or trying to. And that's the thing. I think a lot of times people do. They want to answer a question. They want to seem so knowledgeable, and, you know, and then they'll jump online and they'll research, well, how do you do this? And then the first website that pops up, because everything on the internet is true and correct, they'll use that as their answer. And it's like, no, that's not even anywhere near correct. You didn't even read the entire article. You know, the article threw this section out there saying what not to do, and you thought it was what you were supposed to do. You know, no. You know, so I don't get it half the time.
All right, guys, we're about 1:40 into this show. We got to end it. I can literally sit here and talk to Everett. You know, Everett was one of the first interviews we ever did with Spraywash Pro. In fact, whenever you and I were talking about Spraywash Pro, I was like, well, we got to have Everett on there. He was like, you know, on the list of five that we started with. God, I think we went 2 hours that night of just me and you bullshitting back and forth. I didn't even know what the hell I was doing with Spraywash Pro at that point. Just wanted to talk to you. You've been a good friend, you know, through the years, Everett, and I sure appreciate you.
Thank you.
You know, I know you're amazing. You, for what it's worth, you've got, you know, Doug and I's endorsement for anything and everything. I mean, you're one of those guys that if you told me the sun isn't going to shine tomorrow, I would probably sleep in. So
I appreciate that. For both
you guys. You and Miss Candy have an amazing time in Aruba.
We will.
And we already know. So pre-show, we know what you're doing, but
Oh, Jesus. Yes.
Enjoy yourself. Have fun with that.
Brenda, you be chatty anytime you like. We love you. You're just one of our amazing faves, too.
Hey, Brenda's great. Before you do anything, I want to tell you guys something before we get off.
Brenda, I have a feeling this is something to do with you.
It's Brenda.
Aw.
Brenda got me this. I did not know. She got in touch with Candy and sent me this nice cutting board. It says, "The Wizard of Wood, Everett Abrams. Thank you for your teaching. Thank you for teaching me your knowledge."
Brenda is one of the most thoughtful. Do you still
she
have
really your is.
And I don't have mine in front of me. Brenda is one of the most thoughtful people in the world.
She really is. And I'll
I'm
tell
a baseball you, fan, so it's like a baseball too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And wood.
Brenda sent me some things, and I mean, you know, those are the kind of people that are real and genuine. And
you love them. You want them to succeed. And, yeah.
Well, I think everyone here loves Brenda. If she's not blushing right now, she should be, but we love you, Brenda.
And you want to know something? This is why I love the industry and why I do what I do.
Yeah,
I love people like that. I was blown away by that when I got that.
You know, this I've said to many people, this industry has the most interesting dichotomy in the world, because truly some of my closest friends in the world, some of the people I respect the most, some of the people that I have learned the most from are in this industry. And at the same time, some of the biggest shit heels, it's kind of like Florida. Some of the biggest shitheel scumbags and assholes wind up in this industry as well. I mean, it's like you've got the most amazing and you've got the literal scumbags too. I mean, it is Florida. Cause we have Florida man here that they're just like, you're going, you know, any bizarre crime in the world gets committed. And you're like, oh, that was in Florida, wasn't it? Yes, it was. And it's a beautiful thing about this industry. The hard part is figuring out which one you need to follow, the amazing people or the dumbasses.
That's it.
Absolutely.
It's so true.
We're going to get Brenda to actually speak at a convention one time. We are.
Oh, yeah.
That'd be great.
Brenda, and I'll go right here. Brenda is the kind of person that we need as an instructor in this, you know?
Absolutely.
Brenda, you could do this. We'll give you some tequila beforehand, but no, you're an inspiration. I mean, you remember 5 years ago, Brenda wouldn't touch a freaking ladder. I mean, Brenda was paralyzed about you know.
Well, I still don't think she gets on a roof though. I mean,
but
you still, know.
But she was scared of a ladder. I mean, and look at what Brenda's done to build her business. And we've watched Brenda just become, well, she's doing a $7,500 freaking debt or $5,000
debt. Yeah. You know?
Comes with confidence. She's had some successes and gained confidence. You can tell the difference. It's been great.
It's funny you mentioned that. I literally had a talk with a guy this morning who I guess I'd consider myself a mentor to him. I hope he would consider me one. But, you know, and his business has changed a lot over the last year. And he was telling me the confidence level that he had. And I said, you know, you get used to all of a sudden tossing out $10,000-$15,000 bids, because he even called me and he was like, I'm curious. I'm just second guessing myself. You know, is this too much? I did $12,000.
How many times do you get that?
I did $12,000 for a 2-day job. And I was like, dude, how much have you done so far this year? And he's like, God, you're right. He's like, this is like a momentary moment of weakness that I'm feeling, because you're right. I toss out bids bigger than this all the freaking time. But it's one of those, that swagger that grows with what you do, because I know that myself for the first 5 years, I was like, oh God, oh, it's getting about $5,000. Is that too much? And then it's like, okay, $25,000, bam, send it.
You have to remember that your price is your price is your price is your price. And it is what it is. And yeah, how many times do we get those phone calls? Everett, I'm sure you get the same thing where people call up and, man, I know I've done this like 50 million times, but am I on track here? And you're like, dude, yes, you've been on track the entire time. You know, just go with it. You know where you're at.
Absolutely. And the more you do, it kind of goes back to the old axiom. If you want something done, give it to a busy person to do, somebody that's already busy, because they'll figure out the way to get that shit done. It's kind of like, the same thing. Once you're used to doing stuff, you just get stuff done. You're used to that a 30,000 square foot building is going to be $4,500.
We talked about in the beginning about building trust. Confidence builds trust. When you're confident,
yes, it does. People
trust you, and then they don't mind paying you the money.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many times have you ever seen a beautiful girl with an ugly guy? And it's like so much of that is literally the confidence of the dude. You talk to the guy, and you're like, holy shit, I'm now questioning my manhood because of this little short, fat, balding guy. Oh wait, me. But how confident he was,
Yeah, but you know what? That's okay, Ray, because you know why? It's going to be easy putting sunscreen on.
Hey, there's a lot of truth in that. This is hard to put sunscreen on.
That's right. Stop it with your good hair.
My head burns,
Stop it with your good hair, but
it's still there. So
I got to look at the positives in all this.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
I just wear
Everett. I so appreciate you.
Definitely.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I love coming on here with you guys. I really appreciate you having me. Really.
You got to be on more often, though. I don't know why we wait so long.
We've been remiss in having you. So remember, yeah. Wizard of Wood course, everything you need to know about wood, Spray Wash Pro.
Courses.spraywashacademy.com. Just go to spraywashacademy.com. Go to spraywashpro.com. There's links on there.
Yes, sir.
All that kind of fun stuff. And
when anybody needs, they actually need DRP products.
What is your website for your products, Everett?
The products are deckandwoodstain.com.
Deckandwoodstain.com.
Yep.
Deckandwoodstain.com.
Yep.
There you go.
Brand new website. It's probably not more than a week old.
Very cool.
The old one we took down. So there's deckrestorationplus.com. Bless you. All the products, deckandwoodstain.com.
Deckandwoodstain.com. Mm-hmm. Bingo, bingo, bango.
And then wizardofwood.net.
There you go. All right. Well, I'm going to leave on that last comment there. Look at that. Big Rob, the wizard.
There you go.
Thank you all so much, Everett. Hang around.
We appreciate you very much. Thank you all for
watching.
Thank you.